Welcome to Post-Op Class. I'm Heidi, your dietitian. Today we're going to be reviewing your diet progression, the vitamin program, and working on your vitamin orders. First and foremost, it's always important to remember your weapons. We do want to be using those as our daily checklist. These are the habits that can help you to be able to optimize your results long term. Today is the day, if you're here to see your surgeon, that they will be releasing you to advance your diet. First and foremost, it's always important to keep up with your fluids. We're going to continue to strive for that 64 fluid ounces a day, which is really helping with healing, helping to flush out those waste products. It is important to remember that if you are not hungry, it's okay to skip a meal, but it's not okay to skip those fluids. So we're going to continue to drink consistently throughout the day, keeping those beverages less than 10 calories per 8 ounces. And as we advance the diet, we're separating those fluids from the meals, trying not to drink during the meal or for that hour after. This would also hold true if you choose to do a protein shake as a meal replacement. Those are just like a meal, so we don't count the fluids in the shakes towards your fluids for the day, and you would want to take for an hour after the shake before you start drinking again. Keep up with your activity. We know your energy levels have maybe dipped in this week after surgery, but we have to be using those muscles to tell the body to conserve them. So be setting those goals for purposeful movement. Remember, the Texas physical therapy specialists are available to you to help you to put together these safe and effective programs. So when it comes to advancing your diet, just remember that your stomach is a muscle. It is still healing. So we want to be gentle with this process. We look at eating like an experiment. It's kind of like feeding a new child where you start with one new food at a time. You gradually start increasing the textures of those foods as you know that your body's tolerating. Even in these early phases when you're filling up on small portions, we focus on that purposeful fasting. So you can eat at least twice a day, but no more than 3 times a day. Your process of eating will be just as important as your food choices. So it's no joke going out and getting yourself some toddler silverware can help with that diet progression, because we're going to focus on taking these small bites. Bites should be no bigger than the size of a black bean or the tip of your pinky nail. We take that small bite. We think about chewing each bite really well. We set those utensils down between each bite and pause 1 to 4 minutes. I know that can seem like an eternity, particularly in the early phases, but basically after each bite, you should stop and have a conversation with yourself. How is this feeling on my stomach? Am I getting to the point that I'm feeling satisfied? Because if we're eating quickly, it may only take a couple bites to make you feel uncomfortable. That being said, meals should take at least 15 minutes, but also not longer than 30 minutes. So we're not just sipping on protein shakes all morning long. You take what you can do in a 30-minute period, then you want to set those aside. You have a chance at the next meal to go back and choose proteins. So what are we going to start with? When we remember that your stomach is a muscle, it is still healing. Over this next week or so, you want to keep the consistency of foods that would run through a funnel and be minimizing how much that stomach muscle has to contract. So you could start with a protein shake. You could use any of those that met the guidelines for your preoperative diet. If you'd been doing a powdered shake, we can continue to mix them with things like water, unsweetened almond, cashew, or coconut milk. Or you could begin introducing things like the Fairlife or the HEB Mutopia milk. So regular dairy products like skim, 1%, 2% milk, they're all high in a simple sugar called lactose that makes it like a sugary beverage. These products are unique in that it removes that natural sugar of the lactose, but it also microinfuses it with extra protein. So when we look at the nutrition facts panel, it has a higher protein and lower carbohydrate shift that we're looking for. You just want to be cautious with these products. We are not drinking these with a meal because it would still be a fluid that would cause the stomach to empty more quickly. We are not drinking them in between meals because they have more than 10 calories per 8 ounces, so they could break your fast. And it doesn't have enough protein in and of itself to be a full meal replacement, so you're strictly using these like in your cooking or to mix with your protein shakes to bump that protein level up. Beans could be another option for this week. You can certainly boil, steam, mash your own, or you could use a canned bean. You just want to thin them out with broth or water so they're in a thinner consistency that would run through that funnel. If you're eating them thicker like this out of the can, what you might feel is like a crampy or a wavy sensation after you've eaten. That is your stomach muscle telling you it is not ready to do that mechanical breakdown for you and pare back a little bit on that consistency. Eggs could be another option for this week. We get the protein from an egg, from the egg whites. It doesn't mean you can't do the whole egg, but you do want to include the whites because that's where the protein comes from. I would start with the really fluffy scrambled egg. And the key is with eggs is to take them on your plate, mash them up really well with your fork before you would go to take a small bite. We want to make sure we're focusing on doing that digestion on your plate and in your mouth to minimize how much that stomach muscle has to work while it is healing. Dairy products could be another option for this week. Things like cottage cheese. Ricotta is another that's a little bit higher in protein. If you've been looking at the meal plans on your post-op section of the website, there are recipes for things like a ricotta bake. We could do a 2% shredded cheese. Another patient favorite is the string cheese sticks. If you're taking those small bites, it just kind of dissolves in your mouth. Another option would be the Greek yogurts. We do want to do the Greek yogurt because it is higher in protein. It is confusing anymore going to the yogurt aisle. There are so many different options. Just remember, we're always trying to check that nutrition facts panel, and we're choosing those meals, those products that are higher protein, lower carbohydrate, or the numbers are going to hit about equal. If you're looking and it's still real high carb, low protein, then we want to try to look for an alternative, or we'd need to add protein into that food to make that macronutrient intake work for you. So that means this week, even though it's the right consistency, we're not doing things like cream soups, mashed potatoes, applesauce, oatmeal, cream of wheat. These foods are all still high sugar, high carbohydrate, have very little protein. So they don't help with the healing, but they also can alter those metabolic hormones right out of the gate. Now, everybody's diet progression will go a little differently from here. One may be the volume of foods that you can eat. Some people are only going to be able to eat like a fourth of a cup. Others may be able to eat a half of a cup. That's okay. That's still a portion restriction. We don't require that you're measuring your portions out in this program. We want you to learn to eat to that point that you feel satisfied, as long as we're following the three golden rules, which is those meals are higher protein, lower carbohydrate. We are not eating more than three times a day, and we keep those meals less than 30 minutes. If we're following those guidelines, then you eat to the point that you're just feeling satisfied. Everyone's diet progression will also go differently in how quickly you may feel like you're able to advance your diet. Everybody heals differently. Everybody is in that process of eating slowly differently. On average, most people need to stay on a combination of these step one soft mushy proteins for at least another 7 to 10 days. But once you know you can do well with your step one soft mushy proteins, then you will gradually just start increasing the texture. Add a little more texture to those eggs. Start introducing tender types of proteins, things like a canned meat, tuna packed in water, fish, seafood. Many can do well with the thin sliced lunch meat. You know, you can visualize, it's easy to take a small bite. It's easy to chew it really well. Then you can go into other tender cooking methods like a slow cooker, a pressure cooker, braised. But things like a really dry ground meat, a dry baked chicken breast or pork chop that's really hard to chew and swallow without drinking may also be much harder for that stomach to digest in those early phases. It's not going to be until closer to at least a 5 to 8 week mark before you start transitioning into more solid foods. This will be the transition into your maintenance phase that you're on the rest of your life. We're always going to focus on protein first. We're always going to be mindful of that process of eating, not eating more than two to three times a day and doing those sugar-free liquids in between. But we just gradually start increasing those textures. Now, as weird as it may sound to you right now, it is important to encourage yourself to advance your diet. People can get stuck on soft, mushy proteins. Maybe we know it feels good on the stomach, or we're losing weight and we're afraid to mix things up. But once that stomach muscle heals, it is going to be the tension of those more solid lean proteins and your non-starchy vegetables that will signal to your brain that you're feeling full and satisfied. Soft, mushy proteins will start to become like slider foods. They're going to slip through that anatomy more quickly. You're going to find that you need to eat more in order to feel satisfied, or you start getting hungrier sooner. Those are indicators that we also need to consider the consistency of your food choices. When we meet your adequate protein needs, that's strictly 2 to 3 ounces, or think the size of your first 2 to 3 fingers. When we can do this much protein, is really when you start introducing your non-starchy vegetables. That's where you're going to get your fiber, and it's really what helps to balance out that caloric intake. Non-starchy vegetables are anything other than the corn, peas, or potatoes. Now, you could use small amounts of those as a condiment to your meal prior to that. For example, if you're doing great with your eggs next week and you just want some pieces of mushrooms or onions in there for flavor, that's fine. But when we consistently meet those protein needs of those 2 to 3 ounces, then we begin working our way around the plate. We don't just want to keep doing more and more and more protein. We want to hit those adequate protein needs, then add in our non-starchy vegetables. We will always de-emphasize the carbohydrate intake, remembering that those carbohydrate-based foods can increase your hunger and cravings. They also slow pushing that body into that fat burning. What are poorly tolerated foods the first 6 to 12 weeks? So it takes about 3 to 4 weeks for your external incisions to heal. It really takes like a full 6 to 12 weeks for the full internal healing. So you just want to be gentle with your new anatomy during that time. Avoid really spicy foods. Now, long term, there's no reason you can't do spicy other than you're not drinking with the meal or for an hour after. But your food also doesn't have to be bland. You can use salt and pepper. You can use herbs and spices to make those foods enjoyable for you. Avoid the overuse of really acidic foods, particularly things like tomato juice and tomato soup. Those can be really irritating to the stomach lining while it's healing. We're avoiding those doughy carbohydrate-based foods. Not only do those fill your carb tank, but they also can absorb fluid in the stomach and swell, so they can make you feel really uncomfortable really quickly. We're also trying to avoid rough, abrasive textures. We do have those sutures in the stomach that need time to rest and heal, so we're going to avoid things like coconut, corn, popcorn, nuts, seeds for at least that first 3 months. We're avoiding caffeine during this time, as it also is irritating to that stomach lining. You can use the decaf coffee, decaf tea, but we do need to watch what we put in it. We always try to keep it less than the 10 calories per 8 ounces. We're avoiding alcohol the first year, carbonated beverages long term. And just a note on artificial sweeteners or sugar substitutes, these may be a good alternative to regular sugar. However, just because they don't contribute to your caloric intake, they can affect metabolism in a variety of different ways. So we do want to be cautious of how many of those that we're using. Our recommendation would be to try to stay less than 4 artificially sweetened things in a day.